is the Schaefer Baseball Report, an inside look at America's pastime. From Little League all the way to the big leagues. Now here's your host, former Major League infielder Jeff Schaefer.
Well, hello, everybody. This is number 66 of the Schaefer Baseball Report. In the house today with the usual suspects, John, formerly Chief Tubia, now Easy Cheese Ennis, and Andrew One Tool. And now that he has, I don't know, Pete Sinopoli says that we gave you a glove tool, so you have two tools. You have more than that?
No, I got two right now.
Congratulations, by the way. You're a homeowner.
Oh, yeah, finally.
Yeah, I got your first home.
Now long time coming.
Right?
Yep.
You excited?
Oh, yeah. A lot of work to do, but yeah.
Yeah. Is it going to be like a bachelor pad? Like, you're going to be running them through there left and right? Or what do you think? Huh? You got it all lined up?
No comment.
No? You didn't post on social media, like, I got my own pad?
No, not yet. No. I'll have a man cave in there, though.
You will, because you got a spare bedroom, mm-hmm. right?
Okay. Yeah, I have a man cave, so.
Well, that's good, dude.
Cardinaled out and Vikinged out, so.
All right. Viking. I didn't know you were a Viking fan.
Yeah.
I just thought you got that at the Goodwill, that jersey or something.
No, I'm a Viking fan.
Really? Good for you. Well, yeah. We got a good show today, and we look forward to it, and we will be back right after these messages.
This segment of today's podcast is brought to you by EA Sports Fields. EA Sports Fields provides professional athletic field construction, design, renovation, and maintenance for all levels of play. Former professional groundskeeper for over 20 years, they provide a unique perspective regarding your playing surface. You've heard of the five tools of baseball? EA Sports Fields excels in the five tools of providing an exceptional playing surface for players, owners, groundskeepers, fans, and your community. To learn more about EA Sports Fields, find them on Facebook at EA Sports Fields Incorporated or visit www.easportsfields.com.
All right, let's do it. Coming off another weekend, we went down to the Shipyard and played in a PBR tournament, which was well run. Give them credit for that, well run. And that facility,
haven't been there, but I've seen it.
You've been there?
Nice.
You haven't been there yet, Sean.
Just pictures.
It's cool, man. It really is cool. The whole, you know, the setting is awesome because it sits right on the channel there. Boats going by all the time. People on jet skis. You know, I parked my yacht right over across the way, my big yacht. I think it was
like 7 million?
120 foot yacht. Yeah, somewhere around seven, something like that.
Helicoptered onto it.
Yeah. And then I had my little dinghy there to bring me back and forth to the park. So that was awesome. They didn't miss a beat anywhere in that facility. I mean, everything is top notch, first class, from the fencing going down the foul lines to the netting that's going up to protect the fans. The batting cages were great. They had a beautiful park with a misting on it for the kids. In the center, you got your tower, like we
said, the tower. Nest.
It looks like a tugboat. They design it like a tugboat. They call it the wheelhouse. Mm-hmm. And it was very cool. And, you know, PBR did a good job, man. They had a lot of people there. Scoreboards were running. They were tweeting out on the kids all the time. It was a lot of fun. We definitely do something like that again. And, you know, the competition was good, the competition was good. We had Tri-State Arsenal down there. We had SBA down there. We had us down there. We had the Myers Park group, the Stampede. They competed. They won the older division. We had a good game against them. We ended up beating them. But they had already clinched a place in the finals, and they ended up winning that. Panthers were down there, played a good game against them. We lost that game, but it was a good game, tie and run. And then we went in with our 2022s. What are you smirking at?
You're listing all teams that are out of Charlotte.
I know. And that's we'll get to that point too, because that's part of our facility. And I just got off the phone on the way in here with Mike Colangelo talking about what we're going to do and the dates that we laid out and. You know, creating something
up
at Tuckasegee, Dream Park, Dream Fields. Creating an alliance. You know, you just made a great point. So we go down there, and we play everybody that's right here in Charlotte, or we can play in Charlotte, and our family spent all this money. Now Charleston's a great place, and also the restaurant that they have right there.
Yeah, the experience is great.
It's nice that the families go away and hang out and do that one time. But I mean, we do that all summer long, and we do it all fall long.
Yeah.
So what does that tell you? Where are the better teams coming out of? The Charlotte area. The cities, so why aren't we not just knocking heads here in
Charlotte. It's like teams out of Atlanta. They don't really need to leave the Atlanta, greater Atlanta area. Teams in Charlotte, you can find good competition here. Teams in Raleigh, you can find good competition there. Yeah. It's fun to go mix it up. It's just, you know, when you put price tags on things and you look at all the extra costs that go along with it, you're like, well, that costs us, you know, as a family, it costs us another $1,200 to go down there and play four teams that we could have played right here for about $150.
Yeah. We could, and you know, the hotels and the food and everything else. Again, you know, when you're a family of somewhat privilege, it doesn't affect you as much as you think, because you're going to go away and it's kind of a vacation. And you know, we played early, two days in a row, and second day was 8 o'clock in the morning, so everybody was done and you know back at their hotels by 11:30, and they were off to the beach the whole day. And then we didn't play till the next day. So we played Friday night, Saturday morning, Sunday morning. So we had basically about 20 hours of downtime.
Yeah, it's definitely better to go to a place like Charleston.
Than Pembroke somewhere. Yeah. No doubt about that. But our 2022s did really well. I was impressed. Sam Siz, a 2023, came up, threw a one-hit, one-run shutout. We scored one run in the first inning and shut down a PBR team. We won 1-0. He went 7 innings, a CG, and... you know, it's fun to see a kid like that. You know, do you remember getting called up your first time?
No.
I mean, I'm just saying out of A ball or anything like that. Not necessarily to the big leagues.
Yeah.
But, you know, there's always some anxiety to it.
It's nervous, yeah.
You know, you're trying to fit into the clubhouse. You're hoping, you know, that, you know, you're being called up to stay, not to fill in. Because I've had that too. Like, you go up on like a... You know, you're here for 10 days, and when somebody gets healthy, you know, and then you're sitting there praying that somebody else gets hurt, so you don't go anywhere. And that's the truth, man. I was straight up about that stuff. Listen, I'm here. You know, I want to stay. So, listen, you know, my prayers at night may, you know, ask you to pull a muscle or something like that. I don't want you to get, like, break a bone or end your career, but, you know, you can get hampered for a little while.
Yeah. Well, I was on the pitching side, too. So, I mean, there's a lot more flexibility on that side, just having either 11 or 12 mm-hmm. pitchers on a staff. So, I didn't have to worry about that as much, being, you know, 11 or 12. Mm-hmm. There weren't very many times where I was in that position on a staff. But, yeah, there were some kids that come up. And, you know, the funny thing is when you do get in those situations, man, you know, you go into the game, and the game is exactly the same.
Sure.
But there's so many things that are outside of it, you know, in your peripheral, like, you know, do I know the signs? Do I know this? Do I know that? Right. And you got to sit there and try to sort through all these different things. And it's like, you know, it doesn't matter. I just got to go pitch. I just got to go play. I just got to go hit. I got whatever it is.
I got called up to the big leagues with Seattle. And I had been in the big leagues for a brief time with the White Sox, and then came up again with Seattle. Not enough in the White Sox. I mean, still had anxiety, you know, I say anxiety, just, you know, just big league nervousness. Because I wasn't playing every day, and every time you got in the game, you wanted to, like, I got to do something to stay. I went up with Seattle, and then got sent back down within days, myself and Dave Berber. I don't know if you ever remember that name, Berber, but...
Good reliever.
Yeah, the nice part about getting called up to the big leagues is getting sent down as you fly first class, which means, you're indulging the whole way on both ends. So we're sitting there with Bert. I'm sitting there with Bert, and we're talking. I'm like, man, I'm so pissed at myself because, you know, I felt a little bit, you know, nervous when I was there because I wanted to, you know, I knew I wasn't going to stay in that scenario. I knew I had a chance to come back and stay, but that, you know, all the guys that were playing against in the big leagues, the guys that I played in the minor leagues, mm-hmm. you know, I competed against them and succeeded against them and did well. And all of a sudden, just because we're in a big league uniform in a big league park and you know, there's 40,000 instead of, you know, 3,000, you know, you kind of...
You sit there and try to play above your abilities. And instead of, you know, just sitting back there and doing what got you there in the first place, you sit there and you try to do a little more. Yeah. And then all of a sudden, you're out of your comfort zone.
You're out of it.
And things spiral and things speed up. And I same thing happened with me with Detroit when I got a little bit of an extended time up there. All of a sudden, you know, it's like, oh, I need to throw a little harder and I need to do these kind of things. And it's like, man, I wish I could have taken the same mindset I had when I was 27, 28.
Sure.
To when I was 23, 24, when I got called up for the first time. Because it was, I had a conversation with Greg Maddux the first time I got called up in the next spring training, and he was like, man, you look so nervous out there. Like, everything looks sped up, and you look like you were jacked up and everything. And I was like, at the end of my career, I tried to be like the lowest heart rate guy you could possibly be. Like,
and you've maintained that.
Come out and take my pulse on the mound. Pisses me
off. Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, it's, you know, you get that experience. We see that. It's one of those pieces of advice. You know, you could give it out a million times, but – you know, when we have kids that come to our tryouts or when we go to showcase events and things like that, I mean, I can't emphasize enough to those kids, like, do your thing, you know. Right. Don't sit back here and try to backleg balls. You know, you're a 120 pound you know, middle infielder. Like, stay in, you know, do your thing. Do what got you, that got you to the point where even we're taking a look at you, or schools are interested. Don't sit here and try to, you know, match this donkey over here, or vice versa. You know, do what got you here.
Go play the game like you're playing against your friends in the street, like at Sandlot. If you can do that, and again, you got to the big leagues early the first time. I mean, pretty well. You what are you, 23?
Two.
22. I was 28 getting ready to turn 29 when I got there. And I had been to big league camp all along the way. And, you know, I mean, I always felt like I had good enough numbers at AAA to get the shot to go up, but it never opened up for me. Mm-hmm. It wasn't a matter of not producing. It was a matter of, you know, you had to be in the right place at the right time for things to open up and go. And, you know, even at 28, 29, in playing as many years as I did in AAA, is like, you know, it's tough. It's tough. So,
well, one of the things I will say is in AAA, you see really good baseball. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know what the actual numbers are. I mean, this is just me riffing a little bit, but I would say probably a third to half of the players that you play in the big leagues, you could put right into a AAA game and you could go back and forth. But it's that other half that you sit there and you're like mesmerized by, you know, your Chipper right. Jones and your, sure. you know, Griffey Juniors and stuff like that. Like, you don't run into those guys in AAA, no. you know, and all of a sudden, you know, but that's not the whole game. You know, that's just one player out there on the field. Most sure. of the guys are just like me. You know?
Well, almost 28, 29 years old, a lot of the guys that were superstars were younger than I was. So it wasn't necessarily in all of those guys. It was more like the Canseco's and, you know, that had been up there. And I played against Jose in Double A and all that. But, you know, he turned into Jose Canseco and Mark McGuire and, you know, pretty interesting stuff. But, you know, I tell the kids also, it's, well, you know, example, we're watching the game last night, watching the wild card game. And, you know, these guys come on the mound and I watch that first pitch, right? And if it's way out of the zone,
Here we go.
You know, something is not, you know, there's adrenaline going. There's, you know, there's playoff excitement going. The other thing that you think is.
I tell you what, coming in as a reliever.
Yeah.
Especially like runners on or, you know, in an inning. There's nothing worse than sitting there being like, oh, they want me to throw a fastball here?
Yeah, this could be ugly.
It's like, I don't know if I'm locked in yet. I was like, maybe we just spin a breaking ball yeah. and kind of nibble at a corner with a little breaking ball, some little spinner. It's like, man, if this guy's keyed up and first pitch come in and this thing's going 450 feet.
Yeah, crazy. I felt horrible for the right field. I mean, the Soto guy, that kid's special. I mean, that's Griffey Jr. coming back. I'm telling you, that guy is something different. He's batting fourth. He's 20 years old. He's batting fourth in a playoff team's lineup. You know, that has some pretty good hitters in it, and plays a great outfield. Got a cannon, does it all. But that ball that he hit last night, I'm curious to see. I'm not, you know, exit speed and stuff like that. But that was an exit speed line drive that had to be 115 to 120 because when it got on the ground, it was hot.
Well, it was coming in at 98, too.
Yeah, it was coming in at 98, but it was hot. And, that, you know, we were talking, John and I were talking to Andrew in the lobby, you know, before we sat down, it's that, you know, where they cut the grass, you know, they get that nice design in it, but that when that ball hugs that grass, it takes it almost like a snake. Mm-hmm. And it looked like that ball, you know, that he's playing it correctly, and then it just kind of just grabbed that grass line. It's almost like a putt.
Yeah,
a break
exactly. When you get the, you know, the grass will lay based off of the sun and stuff like that, and it actually affects the putt. Same thing in the outfield. I mean, you know, I was a super shagger. That was
super shagger.
I spent a ton of time.
You're like
in the
Master Fungo,
shagging.
Super shagger.
But yeah, those balls, you know, they would get out on the grass, and you know, I'm sitting back by the warning track as a pitcher, and I mean, they would sit there and they'd move two or three feet on every line that they would cross if they were hugging. It was and that guy came in and he had to come in hot because I mean it was that kind of situation, and you get there and that ball just snaked on him.
If he makes the play, it's tie ball game, man on third,
mm-hmm.
and it gets by him and then
if that ball was just bouncing, he would have been fine.
Sure, he would have been fine.
But it hugged, that's what.
And it was 115 miles an hour coming off the bat because when he swung and hit it, I didn't even see it. Watching on TV, like I didn't even see it exit the bat. I mean, he barreled it up that clean. So that he squared it up that much. You know, there was no. It was that was a great game. So Cards pulled it out on the last day, and I text every game. So I'm in the dugout at.
PBR
Shipyard at the PBR event, and I have my iPad in there while the game's going on. We're in the championship game, but I'm watching, you know, watching my the cards go, and as soon as it's over, I text Lib, Mike's mom, who's she's here in Charlotte, and just text was, how hard are you crying? I mean, can you imagine how special that is for them?
Yeah, man.
Overall, just you never would have dreamt this. You couldn't have scripted this. And so they're going on. That's exciting. They play tomorrow night.
Tomorrow night.
Five, so tonight is a wild card. Tonight is a wild card. Raise Oakland.
Raise Oakland. Yeah.
Yeah, I got Oakland.
I got Oakland as well.
Yeah,
I'd like to see Oakland do it too.
Yeah, I'd like to see the low dollar get as far as it can.
Yeah. Well, the Rays are in that same boat. It's kind of a matchup of very similar philosophies,
right,
as far as the front offices and the makeup of the teams and things like that. We're probably going to see, I would say, five pitchers for each team. We'll pitch tonight.
So both of those guys, they're at one and two, well, the last and almost last in payroll, aren't they?
They're pretty dang close.
I know that Tampa Bay is the lowest. This is the first time ever that the lowest money team has gotten into the playoffs.
Yeah, I would say definitely for sure those two have to be. If they're definitely in the bottom five,
right?
But yeah, I mean, similar philosophies. I mean, they're. Their scouting departments and their developmental side. You got to give a lot of credit to those guys because they consistently, they're not gonna win a whole lot of World Series and things like that. But they are always in the playoff hunt. You don't even notice it, and then all of a sudden you're sitting there in middle of September and you're like, shoot, Oakland.
You could put together a really good team of a lot of good baseball players, and you could put together a really bad team of a couple superstars and not so many good baseball players.
Yeah, you get a couple superstars, and I mean,
they eat up the salary.
Schilt. The manager does play a role in how these guys play.
Big role.
Oh, I love. He's active, man. They're going to steal bases. Which, for a few years, that was kind of like death. It helped them win a game the other day.
I think they had the best. Defense this last year
with two outs. Yeah. So I mean, and they didn't have the best defense last year.
No,
one of the worst.
Yeah.
So listen, pitching, defense, and keeping guys active on the bases going to win ball games.
With the Cardinals, when I look at them, I'm like, their highs are not as high as the Astros can be, as the Yankees can be, as the Dodgers can be, but their lows aren't going to be nearly as
high. In terms of explosive innings and explosive games.
All of a sudden,
the consistency is going to be there. You know what you're going to get
get a grinding game, and you throw that over 162 games, and you've got a really good...
Well, that's perfect. You're right, because at the All-Star break, they were a 500 team.
But you just keep doing the same thing. Guys stay healthy. You got to get knock on wood, and guys stay healthy. But if you go out there and you can grind out 162 games with good, clean management, they're not panicking, and they're not doing these different things. They're just going about their business. And then you see where that can put a team with a good team, not an average team. An average team's not going to do that. You have to have your Goldschmidts, and you have to have some guys like that. But
Goldschmidt's a superstar in the game, right? In people's minds, he's a superstar in the game, but he's not the marquee superstar. He's not
too quiet.
Yeah, he's just laid back. He just does his job. He shows up, goes to the park.
A Mike Trout.
So, when they draft or when they sign free agents,
he's not Mike Trout.
No, not
in terms of personality. Yeah, I was like, wait a minute.
Whoa.
Yeah. But you look at but a Mike Trout could play for St. Louis.
Right.
Because of his makeup, his mental makeup. He's not the most exciting guy on the field is Bader. He's got his sweeping outs and all that stuff. He's a New York kid. He's all pumped up. And they love it. They love it. It's exciting to watch, and it's not going to be tough. My boys were on me the other day. I said, if it ever does come down to the Yankees and the Cardinals, and I grew up a diehard Yankee fan, and I've, Thurman Munson, and Dylan's wearing 15, and, it's for Thurman Munson, and I'm pulling for the Cardinals. I'm jumping off the Yankee boat. Like, the Cardinals are my National League team, but now if Schilt was gone, then I'm not rooting for the Cardinals.
That's right?
Yeah. You gotta go with the human aspect,
That's pretty weak.
That's pretty weak.
Here's the thing.
I'm pretty set. I feel pretty good about it.
I would be ecstatic for Mike, but if the Dodgers are playing the Cardinals,
you're a Dodger
fan. I'm a Dodger.
But you didn't grow up with Michael. But if it was your brother, Managing the Cardinals. Well, that's a bad one.
Well, here's the thing. Either way, I can appreciate it.
Your brother's a mess, man.
Either way, I could appreciate it. You know, it's something, you know, it's a silver lining or whatever mm-hmm. it is, you know, you could say. But, you know, when it comes down to it, like, you know, I got a friend that plays for this team and a friend that plays for that team. If they play in the Super Bowl, you know, but it's a team I grew up with.
But this kid grew up with us. You know what I mean? His family's been our family for, you know, since 82.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, he ran and got hot dogs and shined shoes and hung uniforms and, yeah. you know, and
no, I,
went out
I,
to ground. I mean, he was like, my littlest brother.
I'm not saying that I would be like disappointed or anything, but at the same time, I mean,
you wouldn't be rooting for him?
No, I'd be rooting for my team. I'd be rooting for my guys.
You're gonna burn in hell.
Let's go through these picks. We did it last year with Tommy Viola when he was on here, and I think I won it last year.
You're lying.
No, I picked Boston last year.
You're lying. Okay.
Wow, did you pick Boston last year?
Yeah.
That was rough last year.
Wow, he grabbed that team with 107 wins.
All right, I'll go first. Kay. I'll go first. I have, believe it or not, I have the Twins beating the Yankees.
Really?
They're cursed.
Okay.
I got Twins beating the Yankees. I got the Astros beating the wild card. So whoever the Rays, the Athletics go. Cardinals over the Braves.
Mm-hmm.
And I have the Dodgers going all the way to Dodgers and the Cards in the next round. And then I got the Cards going on.
Okay.
I got the Astros getting all the way to the
World Series. So you got Cardinals winning everything?
Of course, because I'm a loyal human being. human being being the key word there.
Says the Yankee fan over here talking about loyalty.
Who you got, John?
I got Twins beating the Yankees. I got Astros beating the wild card. I got Braves beating the Cards. Dodgers beating the Nats. Dodgers, Astros World Series. Astros in 5 or 6.
So if it's the Astros and the Cards or Astros and the Dodgers, that's going to be good for baseball financially.
Mm-hmm.
If it ends up being
Yankees or Astros.
Freaking Nats in Oakland, that'd be like, I'm not watching.
You wouldn't watch? I'd watch.
I got to watch Soto. I got to watch this kid. My dad's been telling me about this kid all year. My father lives in Annapolis, so he gets all the Nationals games. And we had a big argument years ago about Bryce Harper and Mike Trout. And he kept saying, you know, Harper's this, Harper's that. But he couldn't stay up late enough ever to watch Mike Trout. And I'm like, the best player in the game, Dad, is out in California. You don't even know him. It's Mike Trout. Oh, no, can't be. Whatever.
This is the best.
Yeah.
Quietly, like we're sitting here. Yeah. This is the best player ever.
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 Ever. Yep. I agree. He stayed healthy. He produces every year. He got the big contract. He served, you know, he showed that he deserved the money.
He is literally 5-tool player.
Yep.
Every year you know, it's not who's the MVP. It's who is close enough to Trout that we can give them the MVP.
Right. You know? That's right. Good point.
It's like Bonds losing some of those MVP awards. You know, it's like Bonds was definitely the best player, but you feel bad for giving it to the same guy every year. Michael Jordan dealt with the same thing. It's like, is there somebody who had a good year too that we can maybe give it to? Yeah, he's the best player. The Braves, I mean, Snitker was my manager for several years. So, I mean, I've always, you know, had a soft spot for the Braves, even though, you know, they used to whoop up on the Dodgers in the early 90s. But, and then the Dodgers, I mean, they're the class of the National League. I tell you what, that game worked out. You know, you think you use Scherzer and Strasburg in a game and then you got to come back 2 days later and you're going to be in trouble or whatever. But they got their lefty Corbin going against the Dodgers heavy lefty lineup. I mean, that's really not a bad thing. I think that's going to be a lot tighter series than you would imagine a wild card coming in as. Because now you get Strasburg in 3 and Scherzer in 4 and Corbin back in 5. It's like, oof, this is tough sledding right here.
Yep.
So I got Yankees, I got Astros, and then I have Cardinals and then the Nats. And I have the Nats for that reason. I have the Cards winning everything. Only the big reason, not just because I'm a biased Cardinals fan, but because you look at their last 15 games, that's a tough route right there. They had 10 games on the road.
Oh man, they had seven. They had seven of them against the Cubs.
Yeah, 7 against the Cubs. They played Milwaukee right before.
Not
that.
10 games. Was it 10 games on the road? Because they went to Chicago. Then they went. No, they had seven games on the road. Then they came home for the last three. 7 out of the last 10 were on the road.
Oh, I was saying 10 out of the 15.
10 out of the 15,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, they had a last their last 15 games are tough.
Yeah.
So, I think they're more prepared than any other team right
or,
now.
Or they're more mentally beat down a little bit, too. So, you got to be, you know, I mean, that's a grind. And you grinded it out right to the last day. That's stress.
Or they
that
were. Puts
every single inning in those last 10 days was a stressful inning for any pitcher.
Or, you guys aren't going to like this, but some of the teams you're playing in those last week were pretenders, and it didn't end up being as hard as you thought it was going to be.
I don't think the Cubs were pretending until they put Zobrist on the mound, you know, the last day. Then that was it, because that was Joe Maddon's farewell,
peace out.
The
last 10 days, I think the Cubs were washed, even though maybe the Cardinals didn't know it the first
few days. Rizzo was hurt, yeah.
They were pretty washed up.
But, you know, that's a rivalry, St. Louis and Chicago. They, you know, regardless of what it is, every game means something to the fans. So you don't,
So they should have put a fan in the pitch.
they did in Zobrist. In Zobrist that day. Absolutely did.
You know, I guess for the Nats, kind of, I mean, Dave Martinez was on the hot seat 3 months ago. Mm-hmm. I mean, he was on the super hot seat.
There's a good question. So if Maddon gets into the playoffs, does he come off the hot seat?
If Maddon gets into the playoffs.
Right. And just say he runs the table and goes to the World Series again. I bet you, knowing Joe, he would have said, I'm done. See you later. I did what I was supposed to do for you guys. I'm out. He may end up with the Mets.
I think he likes. Do you remember that Dick Vermeil?
Yeah.
He kind of reminds me of Dick Vermeil. Philadelphia Phillies. He would go in for 3 or 4 years and he'd give you everything, but then it was like he needed to back off and go start again. Like he liked the process more than he actually wanted. You know, he didn't like the stability. Yeah. The stability actually got boring to him. I think Maddon's the same way. Here's the thing. I mean, it's the Angels. Like, I don't know if, you know, I mean, I went into Chicago and won it with a monster payroll. Okay, I
can do that. Right.
You're going into Los Angeles Angels. It's like, it just doesn't seem like a place where you can go and anybody's going to care if you win or not.
Right. No, they don't. I mean, and they have, their stands are phenomenal.
It's a cool stadium. Yeah.
They just laid back watching their iPhones. It's just like an event to go to.
Show
it's
up
like,
in the second, leave in the seventh.
That's it. You know, it's get like, a little tan, get a little tan, get out.
It's just like a no pressure situation to win. And I mean,
Seattle was that way when I was there too. I mean, you know, we wanted to win. Everybody wanted to win, but it wasn't like the end of the world. Like it was almost expected that, you know, when we finished 500 the 1 year, like we had like saluting and cheering and everything in the clubhouse. Like, this is unbelievable. First time we ever made 500.
Ugh.
Yeah, it was tough.
Yeah.
But it was fun going out to the park every day and watching Griffey.
Yeah.
That was pretty cool. That was, for 3 years of, and then Omar come up and watch Omar, you know. See how I said watch?
Yeah.
You got to see watch.
Fly on the wall. Yeah. You got to be a fly on the wall for 5 years.
I got to tell you, I want to jump back down to the tournament this weekend and talk a little bit about some off-season workout stuff, but what we've done. Our pitchers from last year to this year, it's night and day. It's a change. And going through the P5 program, the carving station that we have here, you know, these guys putting in the effort of, you know, dedicating, you know, to mechanics and getting stronger and, you know, just everything about it. I mean, it was amazing to watch, you know, because guys last year that were just kind of, they throw a good inning, but they weren't physical, you know, and then they fall apart and they'd get tired or they, you know, body parts are going in all different directions. And then you and Tim Kirk got them into the, you know, kept them through the program through the whole winter, and it has been amazing to watch across the board. So, you know, listen, that's here at CBC, the P5 pitching program that'll go on in the winter. It's a ranch type of program. You know, we just made them better. You guys did a great job, and I've talked to you all along. You know, the biggest thing with us is, you know, we don't recruit people, right? So we don't go find that big, you know, that dude out there that everybody that's already kind of like polished that could go in and get, you know, Tim Kirk said, you know, come to CBC, home of the under 6 foot pitcher.
Yeah.
You know, which was true this weekend, except we had Reed and we had Stouffer that are both, you know, well over 6 foot, but it was a funny comment. But that guy shoved. They pounded the strike zone. We keep track of first pitch strikes all the time.
You know, it goes back to what I told you I really appreciate about the Cardinals, the grinding mentality.
Mm-hmm.
It's a grinding mentality. You see these guys go out there and get scholarships that, you know, went out and popped a 90 at some showcase event or whatnot. But the guys that do it for the over the course of 60 and 70 and 80 innings that can go out there and bring that consistent kind of mindset and work ethic to what they're doing, those are the guys that end up being much better pitchers. You know, everybody wants the big sexy recruit that that they can, you know, put a stamp on and, hey, there's going to be some major league teams looking at him or whatnot. But guess what? On when you're getting to your regionals and you're going to pitch in ball games and stuff like that, they don't care. They don't care. They want the guy. Right. They want the guy that has put in the work and can go out there and repeat everything.
Well, I'm proud of Bertram, Reed Bertram, and I'm proud of all of our guys. But, you know, the two guys that are just showing, because it goes to that point, they're low 80s lefties, pounding the strike zone, commanding the secondary stuff. You know, they know how to make adjustments because they're physical, right? I mean, if you're not physical, you can't make an adjustment. If you're not strong, your body's just, you're tired, you're out of it. But, you know, they've made adjustments. You know, they're not afraid to pitch backwards. It's been a good fall. It's been a good summer. It's been a good fall with the pitchers, and you guys have done a good job. So, but if anybody's interested in that program, it's, you know, just reach out to us here at CBC, because it's not just open to CBC guys through the winter.
Yeah, if you want to come in and get stronger and give yourself a chance to be healthier, come and give it a whirl.
Yep. Overall, I mean, the winter workout is critical. I get shutting down November. You know, I get down, you know, shutting down the arms and giving those a rest, because it's a grind. Zach, you know, Zach's got a bone spur that we're going to go get removed here. I'm waiting for the phone call for the MRI and everything so we can, and then schedule the surgery. But, you know, it's a grind for some of these guys. And it's a grind for the guys, just that when people are monitoring their pitch counts and their energy levels and stuff like that. We'll see guys that are laboring after 30 pitches. It's like, go get him. He's going to get hurt. But then you have guys that just don't know the difference, and they just grind them out every time out. And then, you know, it's either damage is done, or they're just going to be so fatigued that, you know, we need to shut the arms down. But overall, the winter training is critical. What did you do at the end of each season? And this is going to, I know, Coors Light, shot deer.
Yeah.
Went and got some meat.
October and into November. Like, I mean, it was my off time. Right. I mean, I was down. I come from a family of big-boned people, though. So, I mean, the one thing I had to do was stay on top of cardio. I'd stay on top of a little bit of cardio. So
Cartman.
I couldn't go completely.
I'm not fat. I'm big-boned.
Yeah, that was me. That's me. And then November. I wouldn't. You know what? I never did. I never, like, took 6 weeks off from throwing, or 4 weeks off from throwing, or things like that. Like, I made sure to play a little bit of light toss through October, November, just because I didn't want to lose the feel. I didn't want to come back and just, like, have the ball feel completely foreign in my hand. But getting into November, that's when I'd get heavy lifting. One of the things that I learned later on in my career, which is something we emphasize here in December particularly, is how important the strength part and the flexibility part go together.
Right.
Like, we put a lot of emphasis on that flexibility in December, especially, you know, we're dealing with kids that aren't completely physically mature yet. Right. So it's a super important part, you know, even more important really than, you know, jumping in on the super heavy, you know, squats and things like that, which are important. You know, you want to be able to get stronger, but that flexibility stuff is what's going to allow you to do everything along the line. It's going to keep you healthier too than the actual lifting. So I was big in December, November on heavy lifting. And then January, kind of cruising out, you know, it was almost like sprint time. You know, now I'm speeding everything up. Everything's getting faster, picking up the throwing program, getting off the mound. And then, you know, middle of February, Valentine's Day.
Right, you're heading to spring training.
Heading to spring training, ready to go.
Yeah. I went to Vegas right after the season for about 10 years. As soon as the season was over, got on a plane, packed up, went to Vegas until the point when they put me in anger management. Yeah. Then they told me, you can't go to Vegas. You're going to Western Carolina. I'm better now. I'm so much better. Am I not better?
I don't know you from before. Okay. So I'll say I support you, but that's as far as I can go.
Hi, I'm Jeff, and I'm
angry.
I'll
tell you what. When I was in high school, I went to the flea market and got an ID that said I was from Biloxi, Mississippi, and I was 21. And my senior, don't tell my parents this, my senior year, through the time I was about 23 and moved, you know, moved out here to the
East Coast. You had a Mississippi accent?
I was in Biloxi, so I had my ID from there, but my story was that I was an Army, you know, I was in the Army.
Right.
I was a 16-year-old kid sitting at freaking blackjack tables.
All kids under 18, tune this show out at this point, please.
So I've probably been to Vegas 100 times, and we used to shoot out there on weekends. I'm going to stay at my buddy Evan's house, or I'm going to stay at Joe's house. We'd be in Vegas. Vegas. We'd be staying at Fleabag.
Dropping your Biloxi line.
Oh, man. I got $60. I came home with $60. I'm a winner, man.
Dude. Yeah, I'd do it. I'd pack up, and the last thing I'd head there, and I'd stay. There was probably 2 years that I never even came out of the hotel. You know, I never went on to the strip. Just stayed in a hotel and gambled and ate and went down to the pool and hung out and just, you know, changed it all up. That was my decompression, you know. Go see how much money you can lose in 2 weeks. Good job, Jeff. Well done.
Yeah, I tried not to lose it. I didn't go in with enough to lose. We had to make sure we had gas money to get home, or else, you know, I had to get home from Evan's house then.
When you sit at the table and you change three dealers, and the only time you got off that chair was to go to the bathroom, that...
Yeah, so you're better now.
I'm way better now.
You're better now. Yeah. And part of it is just your prostate is causing you to have to go to the bathroom way more.
Yeah, I got to sit at the table with a bag on.
Hey, there's tables you can blend right in.
Though. I bet there are. But the workout for, you know, and then I got back and then I got right into it because I was opposite than you. I would lose a lot of weight throughout the season. And I'd maybe go into spring training at 165, 170. And there were seasons I ended at, you know, 155. You know, and just drain, playing every single day. And then, you know, especially in the PCL, and you're going into Phoenix, and you're going into, you know, Albuquerque, and you're going into some hot areas. The International League was always nice because you were going up north. You're going to Syracuse, and you're going to Rochester, and you had some cooler nights. But, you know, the training aspect was important to me. But not everybody back then had the same, you know, the same mindset. I knew I had to do it to compete. You know, other guys would just show up and use spring training as their way of getting in shape. But now, you know, you have to. You got to keep up. You got to train. We're bringing Chip Sigmund in here from Europa Sports to train all our kids through the winter, and it's part of their tuition. It's part of their fees. So it's, you know, it's in there. But I put Zach with him on a private one-on-one, and Zach put on 8 pounds of muscle in 2 months. You know, I mean, he's into it. You know, and he saw the results the other day. He punched out 4 in one inning. Ball got past Cormac. You know, it was a tough pitch and kind of
Tyler.
Just trickled. Tyler. Not Cormac, Monaco. You know, but he all of a sudden he saw this because he went, they had him at 82 or something like that, which, you know, he's always been low 70s. And he's, now you can see the jumps, and you can see because of the change in his body and the effort that he's putting in through the P5, through the, you know, getting physical. So he's going to give himself a chance. But if you do not work out in the winter and you think it's just going to happen, you've made a mistake.
It doesn't. I mean, you know, one of the biggest things that I think working out in the off season and going, you know, not just that program, but just having a program that you do, is it creates the kind of mindset where you don't question if you deserve to be out there, or you don't question whether you earned it. You put in the work. You go on the mound, and it's like, I've done everything that I need to do to be in this position. Like, I deserve to be here in this position. So, you know, that's one of the biggest things with, you know, grinding through the off season and doing the running and doing the, you know, all those things that are, I mean, they're not fun. It's not fun to go and do that kind of stuff. But it's what, you know, you deserve it when you get out there during that next summer and you're playing out there and you're in those tough situations, things like that. And you can expect to do well because you did the work.
Right. And you feel good. If you feel good physically, then, you know, it helps you mentally. And it was one of the best off seasons I ever had as far as working out goes. Is I worked as a laborer, Local 66 on Long Island. And I was the guy that, I had to carry wood and sheetrock and all this other stuff to the, you know, to where the construction was going on. But during the winter in Long Island, you got snow, and then the sun comes out and melts. So you're walking in mud, you know, and you can't pull the trucks up to, you know, the construction. You got to park them, you know, 100 yards away. And I had treated like, you know, 2x12, you know, so I'm walking, I'm pressing it, I'm curling it, I'm doing whatever. I didn't even have to go to the gym. I was probably in the best shape, but it was a workout. It's like these mud runs and things like that, or those survival runs. I mean, those people go through those type of workouts. It's not necessarily that you have to lift weights. You know, but you have to do something that's going to create strength. So I want to go back to the tournament stuff. I want to finish up. Our 2022s did win. Great competition throughout the whole thing, right into the last game. And we had a hybrid. We had we had four 2023s come up and help that team. And I'm way proud of that group. But I was talking to Colangelo on the way here, and what we're doing with our complex, where I'm going to go to after we get off here, off Tuckasegee Road here in West Charlotte, is, you know, we're going to try to look to kind of create a general alliance of organizations out there that are competitive, that are good, that want to come in, and we'll do it at every age level all the way through, and we'll make sure that we're competing against each other, you know, annually, you know, in the fall, in the summer, and go vice versa, go up there and do it with them, and
yeah, reciprocate,
and then, you know, this way, you know, you're getting the best competition. We can go out and get the best umpires out there. Clifton Bennett has done a great job with us. You know, get the better umpires, make sure that the college recruiters know that the teams that are coming in are that kind of quality. The facility is going to be gorgeous, you know, and just move forward.
I like the thing I like about the alliance or that kind of thing is you can almost treat it more like an invitational as opposed to a sign up. Mm-hmm. You know, you run into some of those tournaments where it's just like, hey, come and sign up, and it's a mixed bag. You mean you may play two or three teams that have no business being there, and just to get to that one game that you want. I like the idea of being able to control that environment and make sure that you're playing against the right kind of teams. And And you know, you get an organization like the Stars up out of Virginia, and I mean, they're going to have a quality 10. They're going to have a quality 11. They may be great. They may be, but they're not going to be
bad. They're
not going to
be
bad. You're going to get at least a solid team. So that's the most frustrating thing about going into some of these weekends is you'll run through and, you know, mercy rule two or three teams. I would way rather go 1-3 or 2-2,
sure,
and play 3-2 absolutely ball games, 5-4 ball games,
and that's what we did this weekend. That's what PBR put on, a good event. I got to go back and say it was a good event. I mean, all the teams that we played were competitive, and it could any game could have gone either way, and that's what you want to be in, mm-hmm, right? Either game. But so talking about the alliance, one of the thoughts that I had is like, okay, so you find that group, maybe it's 8, you know, maybe it's 12, whatever, but there's a membership, you buy into it. And then you take that war chest of money and you make sure that you use that for college recruiters or your miscellaneous. It's not, so it's in there, and everybody determines, okay, you know, every single weekend you're going to have college recruiters there, mm-hmm, whether it's 5, 10. And then once you start to get that alliance going, you got the better teams in the area together, then you're going to attract more recruiters. We can only pay so many. You can't pay every recruiter that steps on site. But they, if they want to do their job the right way, then they're going to show up and see the best talent.
Yeah, you know, you make sure that you're covering the, you know, a minimum number of them, and then if we do our job and we put the right players out there, they're going to have no choice but to come to that event.
So listen, I never knock anybody for making money and putting a business model together, and the dynamics and the impacts and all these other people, they try to go out and monopolize the fields, which it's their business. It's for them that they're going to do as many tournaments as they can, make as much money as you can, but you can't control what.
It's a sign up.
It's a sign up. You know, it's not, you know, and we want to kind of control that, you know. It's, so those events will still go on and they'll be wherever, but, you know, we want to pull in the
weekends a year, we'll be able to make sure that
we're involved with them. Yeah, sure. Absolutely. We're not running away from it. We're just trying to create listen, with Perfect Game jumping out, and I don't know what PBR is going to do down in Georgia. It's gotten way out of control for our families to go travel. I mean, it's $1,200 just for our families to go down to Charleston, and we're 3 hours away. Hotels, foods, you know, it's $10 a day to check in, you know, it's whatever you got to do. And, you know, maybe $1,200 is a stretch for a 2-day event, but, you know, it runs up close to $3,000 when you go somewhere for a week.
Wow. Not to mention not working for a week.
Not working, you know, for a week.
Week-long tournaments. Yeah.
And it's just, you know, it puts stress on people, and, you know, not everybody will show it or voice it, but, you know, when you got a roster of 16, you know, not everybody is can comfortably handle travel like that, mm-hmm, and doing that, especially on a regular basis. So, but anything, Andrew? We good?
We are good.
We got a game tonight. I'm getting on a plane. I'm going down to, believe it or not, a PG event, but we're doing a pretty cool thing that, you know, we're going to hybrid a team with the Megastars, Charlotte Megastars, Jeff McNeely. We're going to take 8 players from his side, 8 players from our side. We're going to wear our CBC uniforms. They're going to wear the Megastar uniforms. And we're going to go down there and we're just going to compete. You know, no high expectations. We go look to win every game. And if it works out, and, you know, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, we did this and we ended up third. Mm-hmm. It was like smoke and mirrors. We had Will Wilson on that team, though, that got, you know, $3.5 million. He was pretty good, man.
Helpful. That's
he was pretty, yeah, you got one guy like that. It was pretty good. But well, that's it, everybody. So we appreciate this is number 66, the Yasiel Puig Show. Of the Schaefer Baseball Report, and we look forward to talking to you guys next week. So thank you, John. Thank you, Andrew. Peace out.